Once Upon a Time There Was a Canada by Daniel J. Towsey. It was the most beautiful country from sea to shining sea, some 7,000 thousands miles across. The people were so proud and happy. We were free, or so we thought. It was 1967. It was Canada's Confederation year. All was well. Canadian pride was everywhere. The Christian French people of Montreal, Quebec were hosting the best ever World's Fair. It was known as Expo 67. Expo 67 had the most advanced technology brought in from all over the world. The digital world had arrived in Canada, along with computers that would secretly alter the world as we knew it and the nation's votes without anyone knowing it. Please read this article about vote fixing, originally published in 2001. Attachment: Corrupt Canadian Elections. Vote fixing. Let it be known to all, I wrote this document entitled Remedy for Our Stolen Democracy, in hopes that you'll realize that this is information which all free Canadians need to know to ensure the protection of our democracy. This statement has previously been released to all members of our parliament. This has been read by many people online at the Internet's World Wide Web, at public forums, online news medias, and more. Remedy for our stolen democracy. Dear citizens, please read this. Originally written 2001 and revised after June 30, 2002. We in Canada have a very serious problem with corruption in our voting process. It has been going on since approximately 1969. Since the use of computers. I witnessed this as a result of working on a federal election campaign. We have a very old voting system that is extremely flawed. First, it has to be understood how a voting station, polling station, works. Polling stations are manned by public volunteers from all represented parties. All activities and ballot counting is witnessed by them in the polling stations. When a polling station closes, the witnesses manually count all ballots for retrieving. Then the results are reported by telephone to an undisclosed location and local campaign headquarters, at which time the someone sitting at a computer terminal can enter any vote results he or she feels like entering. As there are no witnesses present for this process. In Canada, there is no way to verify those computer results, as all ballots are blank. The ballots are useless once the witnesses leave the polling stations. There is no way to verify the accuracy of the information that is entered in the computer bank. We have no safeguards against the corruption of vote results. Most corruption will occur in highly populated areas, since these activities will likely not be noticed. Another thing to realize is that while the votes are being counted, no one knows what the vote counter results are at the other polling stations in the riding. And in this way, if the results reported on the television are wrong, none of the witnesses will be aware of it. Realize that each riding has many polling stations, so none of the witnesses really knows what the total vote count is for the riding. This makes it very easy to corrupt the vote count. Only the campaign headquarters knows the vote tally. Please understand that once the witnesses take their eyes off the ballot box and leave the polling station, the votes mean nothing. The witness should be given a document signed by every witness indicating the vote count at that polling station. Also, the vote counts for each polling station should be available online after the election so they can be verified and scrutinized by the witnesses to make sure there is no discrepancies or errors. This is not the case, and that omission proves that that is deliberately so. And as I discovered, when the fraud happens, there is no remedy for it. who would believe it? It is to be understood that if even the smallest possibility for vote corruption exists, then all possible safeguards should be put in place for witnesses to eliminate it. I suggest that we put into place a system where all ballots have a unique UPC barcode on the backside. Then each polling station would be allotted a predetermined number of ballots. The location of each and every ballot would be accounted for through the whole voting process. The ballots would randomly and anonymously be given out to voters at each polling station. At the end of the day, the used and unused ballots could be counted manually as well as with a computerized counting machine scanned with computer. All activities need to be monitored by the volunteer, public, witnesses. The ballots will still need to be counted manually. In this way, all ballots will be accounted for in the whole country. To further safeguard, I repeat, each and every volunteer will be given a printed signed copy of the results to keep before they leave the polling station, so that results can be collaborated in the future by the volunteers at an online site or manually through public records. There should also be any other security safeguards put in place to ensure that the possibility for corruption never exists again. Note: the chief reporting electoral officer should have no authority to do any certifying of vote results without public witnesses from the represented parties being present to witness all his certification activities. Our votes need to be protected. Our democracy starts at the polling stations on the day we vote. Let's make sure it does not stop there. I am a proud and free Canadian. Sincerely, Mr. Daniel J. Towsey. All truth passes through three stages. First, it is ridiculed. Second, it is violently opposed, attacked. Third, it is accepted as self-evident. Arthur Schopenhauer, philosopher. 1788 to 1860. Now back to the original article. When I was 9 years old, I lived in the new and modern community of Bayshore in Ottawa. It was a couple of hours away from the Federal Parliament buildings in Ottawa. I used to ride my bicycle to the Parliament buildings. I parked my bicycle under the beautiful Peace Tower. I never had to put a lock on it. In those days, there was no security at all at the Parliament buildings. I walked all through the wonderful and historic structure. It filled me with much pride. I got to learn about Canada's wonderful and proud heritage, our freedoms, justice, and equality. If only I knew then what was to become of this once proud and noble place. I wandered the halls for hours and hours. Day after day, I could walk into any member of Parliament's offices. No one minded. The ministers were the kindest and most sincere people I had ever met in my life. I then had a dream to one day return and sit behind one of those desks. I made it my life's goal. All that changed after my experience with the election system in Toronto in 1984. Up till now, my whole life was filled with nothing but the most horrific child abuses. Long ago I began to write The Snowball Effect. To describe it, I have not finished it. It is so painful to write it. To write it, I have to relive it. As a result of my experiences, I was very keen at recognizing tyrants are decent people. I was always a fast learner. I learned a lot during my visits to Parliament. I was like a sponge. I asked questions all day. The ministers were kindly and intelligent. They loved my inquisitiveness and enthusiasm. They eagerly, enthusiastically, and proudly answered all my questions. I began to learn politics. We had just elected a very sincere and honest new prime minister. Or so we thought. A prime minister that was molded in the public's eye by the media to appear as a very charismatic individual. Known as Pierre Elliott Trudeau. He was not what he was publicly made to appear. He was an absolutely vicious man. Back in Ottawa when I was in the bleachers of the chamber in Parliament. And I watched him during question period. I watched him every time he rose to speak. He always violently yelled at the other ministers that did not agree with him. He was rude and vulgar. He readily swore obscenities at anyone anytime he wanted. I once heard him scream that. Everyone in these chambers is going to do what I say. And that he would not accept anyone disputing what his intentions were. Or they would cease to be members. To me he appeared to be nothing but a dictator. People who knew what he was really about lobbied 4 years to have cameras placed in the Parliament's chamber. So that the public could witness what was happening. Eventually, but much too late, cameras were put in. But the damage had already been done by then. After the cameras were put in, everything else would be done covertly and with deception. Since the public has no control over what the media presents to us, we have all become deceived. Like our democracy and freedoms, Canada's proud heritage will soon completely disappear. The winners, as usual, will continue to rewrite history, and only the old people will remember what Canada was and what has been deceptively done to it. Thanks to the media, Trudeau was able to commit the biggest fraud of all on Canadians. The media made us all love him. He could do no wrong in the public's eyes. So to control us, he spent and he spent and he spent us into debt forever. We all loved him. He built the wonderful Trans-Canada Highway System. He vastly improved our public health system. He gave us our Bill of Rights and he separated Canada from England's control. It appeared that our quality of life was so much better now. Many gained a high income as a result of the flood of new money put into the system. No one dared to say a bad thing about Trudeau. At that time, the Canadian people owned and controlled our currency, known as the Canadian dollar. We have, soon I will be saying had, our own national bank to keep it all in order. It is called the Bank of Canada. The Bank of Canada controlled the amount of money that was produced and put into circulation. This kept inflation in place and maintained our high standard of living. The federal government, Trudeau, never needed to borrow money from commercial banks at interest. After all, where do you think the privately owned commercial banks were getting the money from that they loaned to us? For if our federal government needed funds for capital projects, it had the power and authority to produce it at Canada's mint or just enter the amount into the Bank of Canada accounts. Money does not have to actually materially exist to function. All it takes is just a number in a computer bank account. That is why our fathers of Confederation made sure that the people and not some secret private group controlled the money. If the people do not control their money, then they do not have a democracy. That is the fraud that Trudeau committed against all Canadians. The fraud that he committed was to borrow money from the commercial banks at interest, indebting us forever to the bankers. This also gave the bankers control over us, our economy and future. They now had the financial means to take over our country. This huge influx of constant money gave them the ability to scoop up all valuable money-making enterprises, public utilities, and natural resources. The government then started disposing of all of our public assets to pay off this huge fraudulent debt to the bankers. We once owned and controlled all our natural resources, public utilities, and services. we were considered the best country in the world to live in. People from all over the world chose Canada as their number one destination to immigrate to. We welcomed peoples from all over the world. Canadians were a kind, generous, and simple peoples. Canadians had a policy of sharing the Commonwealth with all peoples of Canada. We put into place a concept known as federal transfer payments, in which federal wealth was shared with the economically poorer provinces. This worked well and no one was deprived of anything to make it happen. Under the North American Union's deep integration plans, we are going to cease having transfer payments. We are going to lose all control of our natural resources. All our civil laws are now going to change. Our public health system will not survive either. For we will be under the full control of the corporate Zionist North American Union Communist government. As Canada will no longer have any money, the bankers are going to have it all when they bring the new Amero currency into circulation. Canada is about to change forever unless the naive people wake up to what I am telling you here. But the takeover of Canada started long ago. It is all part of the Zionist New World Order or globalization. They want to create a one-world government. That is not democracy. That is insanity. After the Second World War, the world bankers knew that to take over Canada would be expensive, and that it would take a lot of money and that they needed to control the money to do it. Before the Second World War, Canada had no income tax. Please read my articles. Income tax is a fraud. And then raid? How can you be taxed when there is no tax? So after the war, they introduced a temporary federal income tax. This tax was just a means to rob and enslave the masses. They said that it was needed to finance and pay off the federal war debt to the world bankers. Up till then, Canada never needed a federal income tax and still does not need one. If we take back the control of our currency, as this country is and was the wealthiest country in the world, our country was and still is abundant in valuable natural resources. They knew that the value of our natural resources was more than enough to quickly pay off the world bankers. Here is a question for you. How can the government tax you without any taxes being taken from you? It's simple. All the government has to do is create cash and spend it. By doing this, they are taxing you. Every time they put money into circulation, it devalues the money that is already in circulation. This is what causes inflation or indirect taxation. For money has no real value unless the people agree to work for it. Your labor is what actually gives real value to money. Otherwise, it's just a piece of paper. This is why there was no income tax before the Second World War. It was not necessary. Why should we, the public, work hard to enrich the bankers and secret society groups? Controlling the money was not enough for these greedy Zionist corporate banksters. They wanted it all. They wanted the whole world, and have bought it with money they now create out of thin air. As the banks are no longer regulated and controlled by we, the common people. After all, Canada is a Commonwealth country. So what happened to our Commonwealth? It has been stolen. That is what happened. They've had the intention of controlling the whole world for a very long time. We now know it as the New World Order. This is written into history going back thousands of years. For proof of this, all you have to do is read the protocols of the learned elders of Zion. During my election campaign experience, I was asked by a friend of mine to work on his federal election campaign. He recruited me because he admired and respected my unwavering honesty and keenness. I could not be corrupted and I refused to give up on my free country. As a result of my experience in the election process, I became a victim of the newly created covert secret police, known as Canadian Secret Intelligence Service, or CSIS, a secret division of the Federal RCMP, Royal Canadian Mounted Police. This organization operates completely out of the public's scrutiny. They are the untouchables. Nothing is beyond their reach. They are not limited by any laws. They can and do assume any identity they choose. Whether that be an honest one or a criminal one, a judge, a doctor, a teacher, a regular police officer, a violent house invader, or anything they want. In that effect, they can deceive anyone to achieve and protect their controller's secret agenda of a new world order. Their financial resources are unlimited. They are a secret force of the secret government. They also recruit or influence anyone they want. They have access to all of the government's resources, personal records and databanks, and will alter those to suit their purposes anytime they want. CSIS does not answer to we the people, to our courts or justice system. They are completely unaccountable. They serve only criminal organizations we'll call corporations. They serve only criminal organizations we call corporations. To prove this is easy. They have converted all our governments to privately owned corporation. Our governments were not corporations before. They were just our governments. They often recruit criminals from police records. I believe that the Young Offenders Act of Secrecy has served them well. They can and do recruit many young people who have violent tendencies. Young people are easily influenced, especially when they think they are functioning under national security and for the good of their government. They really believe they are doing something honorable and redeeming. Those that graduate from the indoctrination process often make the best members for the secret mercenaries that the secret governments of the New World Order operates here and worldwide. CSIS operates under only one policy. That is, do not get discovered, or you will become disposable. It all works as a pyramid system. Those at the bottom of the pyramid never know what is going on above them, unless they get promoted by invitation to the next level up. To get promoted, you have to only pay one price. That is to give up a little more of your conscience. By the time one reaches the top, there is no conscience left. Evil prospers on secrecy. Most people are honest and completely unsuspecting of this machine of deception at work around them and are easy puppets for the deceivers. Some honest and naive people over time have come to realize that something is very wrong with our system and choose to be silent. Then they unknowingly become members and puppets of the secret society that is destroying all of humanity and our environment. Only honest and truthful people are brave. All others are just evil, selfish cowards. Never judge an individual's moral fiber by their economic standing. Those like me who refuse to be corrupted become its victims. Few survive it. All this was confirmed by the police themselves. While I was working on the 1984 federal election campaign, they told me that a contract was put on me by Bob Kaplan, the then Solicitor General of Canada, the same man who created CSIS halfway through the election campaign, and even described what they were going to do to me. They had no fear of telling me, for they knew that no one would ever believe me. And if I ever attempted to tell anyone what was happening, no one would believe me. I would be labeled delusional or just plain crazy. since the government controls everything, they have no difficulty in destroying anyone they want to. The police just love to laugh at me. I became entertainment for them. You are next. They know that the first and most important thing that has to be done to any messenger of truth is to discredit them publicly, and the second is to destroy their ability to earn a living. In less civilized countries, they just torture them for pleasure, then they disappear. We are surely heading there, and fast. I was made CSIS's first project. They then began to terrorize me. While I worked on my friend Michael Cohen's federal election campaign, they began by listing me as Canada's number one criminal in all police databases across the country. In this way, I could not turn to the local police for help, as I had been secretly labeled. CSIS then covertly went on a training mission to completely destroy my life, which they did. This would take another book to tell it all. I have been a victim of covert terror ever since. I have had 9 different attempts on my life. I have been poisoned, drugged, assaulted, hospitalized, falsely charged, imprisoned, and a lot more. They destroyed and/or stole all my possessions and businesses and a lot more. I was not allowed to keep a job. It was so easy for them to do that. I would watch the police walk in and speak with any and all of my employers, friends, family, and even strangers on the street in areas where I socialized. Presently, they are preventing me from receiving any and all medical aid. Note: if you read my recent article entitled "How to Assassinate a Cyclist," you will know what was done to me and that I am now seriously injured and disabled. I now get around in an electric wheelchair. My employers would immediately terminate me. For whatever reason, employers always trusted the authorities and did their bidding. I had no recourse, so I was forced to seek self-employment. Every successful attempt I ever made at setting up a legal business to support myself was destroyed just as my businesses began to succeed. Here is a partial list of my businesses. Dan the Handyman, Towsey's Welding and Auto Repairs, Silver Spoon Trading, Cheap But Good Movers. I even attempted to further my education in attempt to improve my life. I once applied for and received the funding necessary to attend the local public college. I applied for and was accepted into a small appliance repair course. On the first day, a government agent walked into my class and waved to the teacher. They had a quick discussion and the government agent pointed me out to the teacher. The teacher immediately told me that I was not allowed to get an education and threw me out. Also, my dream of becoming a politician was brought to an abrupt end. From now on, it would be a desperate attempt to survive. During the campaign, I discovered that our elections laws did not apply to these people. They violated every election law and committed outright crimes against me and our country. And now that they were secretly controlling our elections, the power of our money, and our major medias, etc., etc., everything was set. All that remained is to keep the public dumbed down and uninformed of our heritage and what a democracy really is. And the deceptions continued. The evil ones were very patient, for they knew that to take over our country it would have to be done cautiously slow, all the while using the media to pacify the people and alter the people's thinking. In 1967, our country had absolutely no debt. The federal government had no debt. The provincial governments had no debt. All the city governments had no debt, school boards, hospitals, etc., etc. There was no public or government debt at all. Today there is not one government body of any kind that is not completely in debt. As a result, the quality and number of public services has gone down due to the so-called cutbacks. The banksters knew how to cheat us of our country and natural resources, and they were doing it well. The naive people did not see what was being done to their once proud and free country. We were deliberately becoming enslaved under the bankers' debt system in the New World Order. The government of Canada, or I should say the people of Canada, owned its national railways known as Canadian National Railway and Canadian Pacific. We owned our national airline, known as Air Canada. Our country was rich in public assets. We the people also owned many other major assets. This country and all its bountiful natural resources once belonged to all of us, and the Commonwealth was shared amongst all commoners. We cherished, protected and conserved our natural resources, wildlife and wilderness. We learned to responsibly manage our natural resources and wildlife with many environmental laws. We also created some of the best social laws in the world. Canada was an example and envy of many other countries of the world. All that has changed. Democracy is coming to an end with the North American Union by 2010. Look into what deep integration is about. Just search for it online. Learn how we are going to have to give up all our laws of protection, our social safety net, our public health system. There is over 300 laws that we have to give up. We also are going to lose all control over our natural assets. The corporations, which were created by the fraudulent money system. Soon we will control us all with the North American Union government. That is the true face of communism. Let's not forget Mr. Mulroney, who forced onto us, against the people's will, the 365-pound, 22,000-page NAFTA agreement, which sealed the takeover of Canada. We are being enslaved forever. History will be rewritten, and once the older generations dies off, no one will even know or understand what a democracy is really supposed to be. We are now about to lose it all. After the North American Union is secretly finalized and put into effect by 2010, all will be lost. Now you know why they brought in gun control. Comments. Dwayne Lusco says, looks like I am one of the first to post a comment. All control is based on money, thus power. The bankrupt United States of America will get worse for the next few months, with a market crash soon to appear. This is to wipe out and steal retirement investments from those who have worked for it and other clueless investors through mutual funds. The dollar is to be destroyed as planned to bring on the Omero as stated. Just substitute the word Canada for the United States in your article. The United States and Canada are in bed together through the District of Columbia. Dwayne Lusco says, absolutely a superior written article, Daniel. The truth will set us free from the New World Order agenda of corruption, dealing with worthless paper currency which controls our lives. My honor goes to you for showing the courage and time in publishing this word of art. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to this. Please share this wisdom and knowledge with everyone. And please understand, you as an individual have just as much power as anyone else. Every one of us need to start speaking the truth. That is the only thing that will keep our society civilized. It's the only thing that would save this planet. You know, today I see everybody around me bought off by the credit system. Everyone's living on credit. And people are basically bankrupt. What I see all around me are people that are lost. And they are morally bankrupt. And they realize they are. The church or anything else isn't going to help you. God will help you like Jesus told you to do. God has nothing to do with a church. You need to speak the truth and share the truth with other people, and you need to start caring for the first time in your life before it's too late. If you read the rest of my articles, you realize that the insane are running this world, and they have a lot more agendas. One of them is called Agenda 21. They are going to depopulate this planet, and they've been doing it for a while. They're lying to us about everything, including the population counts. If you read my article, They Want You Dead is written in stone, you'll get some more understanding. Please come to danieltowsey.wordpress.com or truthsoldier.wordpress.com or many other ones. You can come to 911 Justice Halifax at WordPress. We don't have any time left, people. We really don't. You really got to do something, because we need to have a positive energy and a positive force in this world, which is what God is about. You know, people are saying we're experiencing a pole shift right now. No wonder everybody's so negative. The whole world is being messed up by a bunch of Satanists that are insane. And they think they're gods, and they think that Satan is God. And they think because they have the power of money, you know, that they can do whatever they want. They are doing whatever they want because everyone's being a coward. Everyone's being afraid to seek the truth and speak it. Stop living for money and start living for love. Love of this planet, love of other people. And love can't exist without you knowing truth.